The following program is brought to you by Caltech.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for all coming. I think that this is going to be an exciting set of lectures. We're going to have four lectures in this short course, and the first one is going to be given by Dr. Slava Turyshev. Slava is one of our colleagues at Jet Propulsion Laboratory. He's been there for a while, and he's a research scientist. He got his PhD and master's both from Moscow State University in Russia in 1990 and 1987, respectively. During the time that he's been at JPL, he's thought a lot about gravitational experiments that could be done in space. He's thought about relativistic cosmology and alternative theories for gravity. He's worked on lunar and interplanetary laser ranging, pulsar timing experiments. He's done work on long baseline optical interferometry, and the list goes on, so I'll stop there. But he has a very broad background, and he's been around and doing a lot of interesting research, so it's a great pleasure to introduce him to give our first lecture.
Thank you, Boris, and good morning, everyone. I'm Slava Turyshev. I'm very pleased to be here today at this wonderful auditorium, and we are going to talk about testing relativistic gravity in space, because this is what I like, and this is why I came to JPL, because it's a wonderful place to be in, and essentially because we have so much different data that can be used for testing gravity. And this is the focus of my talk today. So we will talk about the brief history of those tests, how they were conducted, and then we'll move into the progress, recent progress that was achieved recently, and then we'll probably talk about future directions where the test might go. So the outline of my talk is here. So get ready for many tables, many charts, graphs, but basically that would provide you a nice overview, I hope, for basically the history of tests of general relativity in the 20th century. Then we'll talk about frameworks that we were using to test gravity, essentially parameterized post-Newtonian formalism. And then we'll talk about Robertson and Mansouri Sexel framework that was used to test special relativity specifically. And then I will highlight recent progress in the tests of gravity that we achieved in the 20th century. And then moving on to the present day, what are the motivations to achieve even higher precision in the tests? And then what is to expect in the near future? And basically, I will highlight a few experiments that were proposed recently, and then we'll see if the time permits, I will talk maybe about those experiments in a little bit more details. Main objective here is, of course, to remind where we came from and what is ahead of us. And basically, the themes for discussions here, maybe after the talk, essentially those that are the solar system tests still relevant, still useful for improving tests of gravity? And then is there discovery potential in the tests of gravity, in the solar system especially? And then what is the importance of those limits, of the improving limits in the tests? So this is very interesting because we live in the solar system. This is a gravity field that we are given and how we can utilize that gravity field. Because as opposed to accelerator physics where we can increase the energy, we are given the energy here and how we can be smart to utilize what we have in the solar system. My laboratory in the solar system, I'm not going farther, but I will be here in this auditorium, but we'll be talking about the solar system. That's sort of the limits of my boundaries where I will go today. And essentially, what test is still viable? What test is still useful? But before we go there, let's go a few hundred years ago in the past. So 19th century, 1845, there was a wonderful triumph of mathematical astronomy. And essentially, 1845, Urbain de Leverrier, at that time he was the director of Paris Observatory. It was a wonderful year when he realized that basically there was anomalous in Uranus's orbit. And this is how Neptune came about. because based on Newtonian gravity, he was able to calculate position. And he and Adams got position of Neptune quite Adams's position here and Le Verrier's position here. And of course, in 1945, the planet of Neptune was discovered. And he was so excited when he realized that based on the calculations, he can discover a new planet in the solar system. Therefore, when people were talking about the anomalous precession of the Mercury in orbit, he realized maybe there is another planet hidden just between the orbit of Mercury. There was another planet just between the Sun and the Mercury. And he actually conjectured that there is a planet, he called it Vulcan, and he actually thought that he observed that Vulcan, that planet, but nobody confirmed that. So that was an interesting coincidence that based on the Newtonian gravity, he was able to confirm the Newtonian gravity, he was able to find the planet of Neptune, essentially he cast a doubt on Newtonian gravity because Mercury was not following Newtonian physics, and therefore there was in Newtonian gravity you see a wonderful ellipse here, but in general relativity as we know it, the orbit precesses, and that was the puzzle that was not explained within Newtonian gravity. So that a precession is roughly 43 arcseconds per century, and as I said, it's not explained within Newtonian gravity even after we account for all the planets and all the perturbations. And it took Einstein, when he, before publishing his paper in 1915 on general relativity, he computed a possible orbit of Mercury. And when he, after his computation, he realized that yes, expected precession of Mercurian perihelion was about 43 arcseconds per century. When he done that, he realized that yes, new era in tests of gravity has just begun. And almost in one year, Le Verrier was able to confirm Newtonian gravity, and then he cast doubt on the same Newtonian gravity that he was using successfully in studying planetary motion in the solar system. So that was the triumph in 19th century. And we know that first experiment ever conducted to test gravity, general relativity, was done by Eddington. And at that time, in the time of Eddington expedition by Eddington in 1919, there were wonderful three possible outcomes of this experiment. It is very, very difficult to achieve today because today we're pretty much testing zero. But back then, we had three possible outcomes. And the first outcome was, of course, people were arguing that propagation of light will not be affected by gravitational field, therefore deflection of light would be zero. And then, based on the early versions of equivalence principle, and also based on Newtonian physics, there was an expectation that light will be deflected by solar gravity by 0.87 seconds of arc. And Einstein suggested that it will be twice that amount, 1.75. And as we know, Eddington conducted his test, and it was quite difficult to have that expedition first of all, to get the funding for that expedition and then to conduct the test. And ultimately, the weather did not cooperate, and he was able to see eclipse only just a few hours before the eclipse actually happened, because on the island of Principe, there was a very thick cloud cover. And so when the actually sky broke, he was able to collect the data, but his results were somewhat inconclusive, but people were arguing that there was a confirmation bias in the time. And so based on his first initial analysis of photographic plates, he came up with a result somewhere between 0.9 and 1.8 seconds of arc. And so that was sort of initial analysis of his data. Later on, it was some people reanalyzed the data quite recently, almost 10 years ago, and they actually confirmed that within 10%, Eddington got it right. So essentially, using the old photographic plates, we're able to process the data again, and so we have to give him credit. So Eddington is here, Einstein is here, sitting in Cambridge in 1930s. And Campbell's American astronomer, director of Lick Observatory, conducted similar studies only few years after Eddington's analysis. And here, the telegram that he sent to Einstein saying that the Einstein's deflection of light was estimated between 1.59 and 1.86 seconds of arc. So basically, that was experiment that was done by Campbell only 4 years after Eddington's analysis, confirming really the general relativity. And so basically it was very solid confirmation that yes, indeed, GR works to explain a gravitational deflection of light. This is the formula for this effect. And on the solar LIMP, you see it depends on the radius of the sun and impact parameter. And parameter gamma that we will be talking about through the lecture today, parameter gamma is the measure of non-linearity in gravitational, it is the measure how much a point mass produces a curvature of space-time around it. Essentially, we will talk about gamma. Today we know that gamma was measured by the Cassini experiment to the level of roughly 10 to the minus 5. And so, but there's some motivation to test even beyond that level. So this is first ever experiment conducted to test general relativity. And we know that today GR works everywhere in the solar system. So we see those wonderful Einstein arcs suggesting that general relativity can be used to light is being affected by the gravitational field, and you see those deflections of light, and you see microlensing events. So we use general relativity to study other phenomena in the universe. But let's go even further in time. So this is the set of theories that people were suggesting to explain gravitational phenomena throughout the years. In this table, I listed some of the theories that were proposed in the 20th century and a little bit earlier, essentially starting from Newton. I'm not saying that this is the complete list. This is just an example of different theories that people were putting together. And of course, those theories are very different from each other. They're very distinct. Some people were using scalar fields to explain explain gravitation. Some people were using vector fields. Some people were using mixture of the two. And then, of course, tensor fields were used. And then again, the mixture between tensor, vector, and scalar fields. I'm not going to talk about each of those theories in detail, but I will just highlight that basically some people were proposing not one, not two, but multiple theories throughout the years, because it was an interesting task for theorists to propose something that would be very distinct from general relativity. And because at that time there was not enough experimental data to actually tell between those theories, people were proposing very different formulations still within a few tests that were available at that time. For example, a deflection of light or a gravitational time delay that we'll be talking through the lecture. But some people were, at that time it was very interesting because experimental data base was not big enough, so people were suggesting different formulations. And some theories just variations of others. Some theories were proposed in the very early 20th century, but once we started the space era, once we started to test gravitation to very high precision, it became even more interesting, because in 1960s and 1970s, when the space era began, so we were suddenly a lot of data became available, and essentially people were trying to put a phenomenological framework that was initiated here at Caltech. Kip Thorne, Cliff Will, and Ken Nordvedt, they started work in parameterized post-Newtonian gravity, and some parameters, I think it was in PhD thesis of Cliff Will, essentially when he laid the groundwork for a phenomenological approach how to attack gravitation in terms of high-precision experiments. And later on, it became parameterized post-Newtonian framework with many parameters that we can test through experiments. And I will talk about this framework later. But looking at this list, this list is incomplete. And just to cover myself, I'm saying, yes, it's overlooked. There's some theories that I didn't touch in this presentation. Just don't not necessarily have any strong opinion against or something. But this is something as an example. Let's put set of filters, how we process this number of theories. And very simple set of filters is here. So a theory must be complete. It should be not a law, but a theory. We can derive experimental results based on first principles. It must be self-consistent. Get the same results no matter which mathematics or tools are used. And then, of course, it must be relativistic. Non-gravitational laws of physics are those that are prescribed by a special relativity. And then it has to be Newtonian. It has to have valid Newtonian limit. And based on that, we can eliminate quite a few theories right away. So that's sort of the step that I will be taking one after another by applying different set of physical constraints on the possible field of theoretical thinking, how we can explain gravitational. For example, Newtonian theory of gravity, 1686, is just non-relativistic. It's explicit action on the distance. Then we talk about Poincaré, Fields-Pauli framework that became very important very recently when we start talking about massive gravitons and possible contributions of massive gravitons to explain phenomena that we see in the large horizon scale physics. So then some theories were just, for example, in Birkhoff theory, it's not Newtonian, it demands that the speed of light equal to the speed of sound. And I will not be going through those theories one by one, but essentially each of those theories that will be eliminated from the list will have a certain conflict with the reasonable approach that we take in understanding what gravitational is. So then in 1960s, it was very interesting development when people were thinking about how to explain equivalence principle. And as we know it, equivalence principle today consists of three basic postulates, or three principles. It's uniqueness of free fall, validity of local Lorentz invariance, and validity of local position invariance. I will talk about those three in the next few charts. But basically, if we impose the validity of equivalence principle, we see that theory by Kaluza-Klein and Belefante-Suihart, those theories are not valid. This is very interesting theory because it's multidimensional. It's not four dimensions. It's they impose another fifth dimension. And Kaluza-Klein theories, or class of those theories, very recently became again very popular as a possibility of embed physics in a multidimensional manifold, and trying to explain physics from that standpoint. So, but at that time, based on the initial formulation of this theory was not considered viable based on the fact that it confronts Einstein's equivalence principle. So here, basically, Belefante-Suihart theory of 1975 is not a metric theory, because if we impose validity of Einstein's equivalence principle, pretty much you can see that it mandates that a theory must have gravitation must have a metric nature. And so essentially gravity is and matter interact through a metric field. And that this is why some only metric theories of gravity are viable in the context of studying gravitation, especially in the weak field limit. So let's talk about experiments that were conducted to improve the test of equivalence principle. Starting from Otrich experiment in very late 19th century, when he conducted his initial experiments, which measured equivalence principle to the level of roughly 10 to the minus 8. And what we measure here on the y-axis is delta A over A. What is delta A is basically when we study the free fall of two bodies composed from different material, and we study their falling in the uniform field, uniform gravitational field. And so when we study acceleration of each of those bodies, the difference between the two accelerations divided by the sum of the two accelerations, essentially this is Otrich parameter. And studying those experiments all the way from the late 1990s, from the beginning of 20th century all the way to pretty much present day, we see that the test improved from 10 to the minus 8 to roughly 10 to the minus 13. And the most impressive progress in those tests was achieved in the laboratory experiments conducted in Seattle in the group of Eric Edelberger. And essentially, this is Otrich experiment. What they were measuring is the equivalence between forces of inertia and forces of gravity. Remember those famous Einstein's elevator, that an observer moving in a word line cannot distinguish between gravitational effect and the inertial acceleration, essentially on the word line. But if this observer will start moving in the elevator or start dancing in the elevator, he will immediately feel different forces, which come into the picture. But here, equivalence between inertial and gravitational masses, it's very important outcome of this principle, uniqueness of free fall, and this this equivalence will be tested in many different experiments. When we start putting these thoughts together, we see that delta A over A, the Ertosh parameter, can be composed, as I mentioned, the difference between the accelerations of the body divided by the half of the sum of these accelerations. When we analyze this formula from the standpoint of parametrized post-Newtonian formalism, we can see that basically at some point we can arrive to the to this expression, which will be equal to the difference between ratio of gravitational to inertial mass of one body minus gravitational to inertial mass of the second body. This is very interesting because if we start studying the strong equivalence principle, when we also put gravitational energy into the mix, not in addition to all the other interactions, in the parameterized post-Newtonian formalism, we can express this ratio mg over mi, which will be equal 1 plus this ratio, where omega is the gravitational self-binding energy, and this is the energy of its rest mass multiplied by the speed of light squared. Eta is a dimensionless parameter, and in general relativity, eta is pretty much is zero. But for arbitrary theory of gravity, such as scalar tensor theory or any other theory, which they analyzed in the parameterized post-Newtonian context, you see that eta is equal to 4 beta minus gamma minus 3. For parameter beta and gamma, the two Eddington parameters that Eddington essentially introduced in the 1920s, to explain possible deviations from general relativity. And those parameter beta and gamma are both equal 1 in general relativity. And you see that in general relativity, delta A over A is pretty much 0. It doesn't depend on the gravitational self-energy. So in the sense, to test strong equivalence principle, you need gravitational bodies of the large planetary sizes. And we do that by studying, for example, lunar lazy ranging. Those experiments that were done since 1960, since the beginning of 1970s, when the Apollo landers landed on the moon, and essentially astronauts carried out from the landers arrays of retro reflectors. And since that time, we are ranging to those arrays. And it takes light to get from the Earth to the moon roughly 1.5 seconds round trip. But then we measure the distance to a few millimeters presently. And so the distance is roughly, 380,000 kilometers, and we measure the distance to a few millimeters. And that precision gives us a lot of information as to how this binary, the Earth and, this, and the moon moving in the gravitational field of the sun. Essentially what we do, we drop Earth and the moon in the gravity field of the sun. And we study the difference of these accelerations between Earth and the moon, because basically they have different composition, these two bodies, and dropping the two bodies in the gravitational field of the sun allows us to conduct the same type of experiments that were done in the laboratory, dropping two different masses or providing them with different set of dynamical conditions. And so let me also highlight a couple things. First of all, in this chart, we see that there are some funded projects, the projects that were either conducted or those projects that sort of already been done in the past. So this is the present history. But looking in the future, what to expect in the near future? There are a few experiments that are already running, and there are some experiments that will be in operation very soon. Apache Point Observatory, Lunar Laser Ranging Operation. This is a very recent coming facility for to enable lunar laser ranging that is funded by a National Science Foundation and NASA, and it is operational since 2005. They are ranging the moon with precision roughly 5 millimeters today. So we are limited by inability to model the lunar interior now, and there are some effects that are coming from basic physics such as thermal expansions and solar radiation pressure, and some interesting phenomena on the level of roughly just under 1 centimeter. We have a very good model which allows us to feed the data to roughly 25 millimeters, but getting down to few millimeters is a challenge because so many different effects coming into the picture. And at some point, maybe in few years down the road, we will be able to fit this data to a few millimeters, and then we should be able to see if the moon has liquid core, and if inside the liquid core there is a solid core, because the data that we have now indicates just that. So we have a very interesting way of looking into the interior of the moon. But then, in addition to the lunar interior, of course, we are able to study the dynamics of the lunar motion around the Earth. And essentially, by that, we can study the possible temporal variation in a gravitational constant, and we are able to test for equivalence principle. So Apache Point is expected to reach precision of a few millimeters. I would say maybe in a few years. So I should probably move this date to roughly to 2020. But this is what to expect in the near future. Then Microscope will be launched in 2014. And Microscope is a French mission, which is funded partially by the CNES, French Space Agency, and also by ESA. And so Microscope should be able to check equivalence principle to the level of roughly 10 to the minus 15. In addition to those missions, those that are in magenta colors, those that are just proposed projects that are not funded yet, but people are thinking very hard as to how to improve those tests of equivalence principle below the level that is achievable, will be achieved by those experiments that are in the running already. And the most important, I think, the most challenging, of course, is the space test of equivalence principle, which is trying to test equivalence principle to the level of 10 to the minus 18. This project was studied for a number of years since probably very late 80s, and it was studied here in the United States and also in Europe, funded by ESA and NASA. But still, this project is in the design stage, and it's not funded currently, but there are many people who would like to see it flying. GG, Galileo Galilei, is an Italian project that is led by Anna Nobili, and Anna is very eager to see her mission flying as a small payload in the upcoming Cosmic Vision exercise, and hopefully she will be able to get some action pretty soon. But then, so this experiment is very different from what STEP is doing, and so very interesting to see if she will succeed to get her project funded. What is here, which is very relevant to what we'll be talking today, this is essentially quantum project that is using atoms to test equivalence principle. I think they will be using two species of rubidium atoms and trying to test equivalence principle to the level of 10 to the minus 16. This is very interesting because new technologies are coming into the field of general test of general relativity, and especially quantum, the cold atoms, which is a very promising and emerging technology as far as the test of gravity are concerned. I will be talking about precision clocks and atom interferometers throughout the talk, but so sort of here, this is one of the projects which is being studied in Europe. And this is, in addition to Qantas, there are some other experiments that are being now considered by European Space Agency for the purposes of improving the test of gravitation using very simple atomic systems. Moving on, so there is another principle that we... Yes?
Those are weak equivalence principles, right? Stronger relativity of all.
Correct. Basically, all of those experiments, with the one exception, Apollo, Phobos laser engine. This is lunar laser engine and the Phobos laser engine. These are the two that are going to be studying strong equivalence principle. Everything else is a weak equivalence principle. So this pretty much laboratory experiments where we don't really have access to a large gravitational binding energy. And only with Phobos experiment and Apache and lunar laser engine, we have access to much larger gravitational binding energy. So moving on, testing for Lorentz invariants. Those theories that violate Lorentz invariants are already in the red here. They're quasi-linear theories that predict existence of preferred frame effects. And so essentially, in general relativity, all reference frames are equivalent. And essentially, you can it's a principle of covariance. When you have a different set of coordinates, you can transform, you can go to different reference frame, but physics is still the same. But some theories actually predicted existence of preferred frame where some physical phenomena would obey a different law. So essentially, slightly modified and some preferred frames were predicted in Desert-Laurent and Bollini Gambiaggi Timno theory in 1970. So those theories that predict existence of preferred frame essentially violate Lorentz invariants. Moving on, this is the set of experiments that were conducted to test Lorentz invariants, starting from the famous Michelson-Morley experiment. And the parameter delta here is expressed as a ratio of the speed of light with respect to speed of sort of basic massless field propagation that is prescribed by a particular theory. And so, for example, Michelson-Morley experiment measured that parameter delta to roughly 10 to the minus 2. And moving on, this is a wonderful field where precision clocks are coming very helpful. Cavities and precision clock comparison are very important to test Lorentz invariants. And many theories, many experiments were conducted to really improve those tests. What Lorentz invariants is it suggests that outcome of very small scale experiments essentially does not depend on orientation or velocity of the laboratory. So it doesn't matter how your laboratory moves in the inertial space, experiments should not feel the difference in, from the standpoint of Lorentz local invariants. Many experiments have been proposed using clock comparison, especially using clocks in space, and many experiments were done using clocks in space, essentially transponder experiments, laser ranging, or transponder experiments, ranging experiments with a clock on a spacecraft. One way of light propagation is very important. Essentially, when we have a clock on the spacecraft, we can study one-way light radio wave propagation to and from the spacecraft. This is very interesting because we can test local Lorentz invariants. Those experiments that were conducted essentially by different groups using either Michelson-Morley experiments or centrifuge experiments or using Hughes-Driver experiments. So this is the current state of test of local Lorentz invariants. But those experiments were very interesting to actually test the foundation of general relativity, which is, in a sense, when we take gravity away, special relativity remains there. And the framework that was done by Mansoor and Sexel in 1977 was very handy to test for any possible violation of Lorentz invariants. Being put in simple terms, when you have Lorentz transformation and you basically put by hand some parameters which may be velocity-dependent terms. So when you expand this Lorentz transformation, we're putting by hand essentially parameter A, which is dependent on V over C squared through parameter alpha and beta and delta. In special theory of relativity, you see parameter alpha is minus 1/2, parameter beta is just 1/2, and delta is 0. So now you are able, by doing this, you are able to expand your parameter set and essentially check for a possible orientation or velocity dependence of your experiments. And it is interesting because you have a natural, we have natural frame which is set by cosmic microwave background, and we have laboratory frames. So basically we have few velocities or few direction of motion available to us to see if our solar system or laboratory on Earth moving with respect to those directions. And these are the interesting outcomes of this framework. When we talk about Michelson-Morley experiment, which is orientation dependent, we are dealing with this combination of parameters, which is 1/2 minus beta plus delta. Kennedy-Thorndike experiment, which are velocity dependent terms, will have parameter beta and alpha in this in the amplitude. And then the contraction and dilation are being sensitive to parameter alpha only. So those tests that were conducted recently, starting from the beginning of this decade to roughly 2009, were able to test those parameters to very impressive precision. Michelson-Morley parameter was tested to roughly 10 to the minus 12, and then Kennedy-Thorndike experiments conducted by Peter Wolf and colleagues tested parameter Kennedy-Thorndike combination to 10 to the minus 7. And then testing contraction and dilation was done to similar precision. So that's how well we know that our laboratory in locally obeys Lorentz invariants and essentially does not depend on orientation or velocity of the motion. And in addition to those tests, the experiments conducted by Harriman et al. In reporting in 2009 tested the isotropy of the speed of light to very impressive precision 10 to the minus 17. So these are all laboratory experiments, which are very important when we think about astrophysics and cosmology, which we'll be discussing in the next few talks. But this is the foundation which we use to move from the solar system going out and studying the universe. So moving on, there is another set of principles we called a local position invariance. And local position invariance, basically, you see those theories already violating local position invariance. Based on different principles, essentially, those theories would use not four-dimension manifold, but basically three dimensions plus another dimension for time, or two-time dimensions, or different stratified theories of gravitation, which would prescribe different backgrounds for propagation massless and massive fields. And so essentially, those theories that would violate local position invariance are shown here on this list. And so as we move forward, you see how those theories will be eliminated one by one through this list from applying different principles that we discuss. But local position invariance, this is a set of experiments that are very interesting. Again, what we test here is a parameter alpha, studying gravitational redshift in this case. And the local position invariance suggests that outcome of any local non-gravitational experiment is independent on when and where in the universe the experiment is conducted. So it doesn't matter if we conduct experiment on the surface of Earth or using spacecraft or studying spectra of extra solar system sources. And essentially going from Pound-Rebka experiment and including hydrogen measure experiment that was done by Bob Vessel in Smithsonian Observatory, and all the way to the future planned mission that is ACES, Atomic Clock Ensemble in Space. So Atomic Clock Ensemble in Space is going to be launched in a few years by European Space Agency. It is well funded now, and so it attempts to test for redshift in particular parameter alpha to 10 to the minus, approaching 10 to the minus 7. But there was a very interesting recent result that still is being debated in a sense, using Bose-Einstein condensates to test for local position invariance, and using Bose-Einstein condensate done by Müller, Peterson, Chu, and reported in 2010. This BEC interferometry essentially was able to access the region of roughly 10 to the minus, approaching 10 to the minus 9, which show how interesting the new technology is, promising us even better precision. And essentially, Bose-Einstein condensates may come very handy in many different fields, especially here, local position invariance. Why we are sensitive to, they conducted a laboratory experiments, but why would you ask they are sensitive to local position invariance? As the Earth moves around the Sun, it moves on elliptical orbit, right? So gravitational field of the Sun varies because of the ellipticity of the orbit. So the laboratory is being submerged in a different gravity field throughout the year. So essentially, you can check for alpha just that. So delta nu over nu is the frequency of your oscillator that you are using, and the variation of gravitational potential throughout the orbit of the Sun, of the Earth moving around the Sun. So they were able to check for a possible violation of local position invariance to the level of roughly 10 to the minus 8, 7 times 10 to the minus 9. And ACES is only going to achieve that result in maybe a few years down the road. So it shows the sort of, in some sense, high promise of the new technologies that we are going to talk about through this workshop, and the test of gravity, which is very impressive. Moving on, let's go back to the basics of general relativity. I will bother you with a few charts where I will show some equations, but it just very lightly. In a sense, so I'm talking about the action of general relativity, which is very simple in mathematical terms. We're talking about the Ricci scalar. Ricci scalar is composed from Ricci tensor and the gravitational metric. And the metric of a space-time, the Ricci tensor is given here, which is a function of essentially the Christoffel symbols. Christoffel symbol is the first derivative of the metric tensor. Then the Riemann, the Ricci tensor will give you second derivative of the metric tensor. When you add to the mix the action of a standard model, which is given generically here, and you take a simple variational principle, you can essentially arrive to equations of general relativity, where in addition to the standard terms of this that are known in the equation, I have put the cosmological parameter in. And so cosmological term here, lambda, is measured recently by WMAP experiment, essentially, when we impose the vacuum density, and essentially it leads to very small value for parameter lambda, and essentially no experiments in the solar system are going to be sensitive to a cosmological constant, essentially. And cosmological constant will produce no measurable contribution to any experiments in the near future in the solar system. Pretty much this contribution is roughly 8 orders of magnitude below the present level. So it's not really possible to test for a cosmological constant in any experiment in the solar system. Therefore, in the future, discussion in this context, today I will just not use that parameter because it doesn't contribute. As an alternative to general relativity, people consider it as scalar tensor theories of gravity. And here I show a very simple extension of the simple and elegant action of general relativity onto a generic scalar tensor theory, where function f is a function of a scalar field, g is also a function of a scalar field. This is the kinetic term, this is potential term, and very simple combination of those functions produces a famous Brans-Dicke theory that was proposed in 1961, where you take f of y is basically just the phi, and so with these parameters, set of functions, you get a very famous Brans-Dicke theory. Why I'm talking about this is that for each particular theory of gravity, we can produce expansion of the theory in terms of weak gravitational field at slow motion. And this is looking at the metric tensor that is coming into these equations here and there. This is essentially the structure of the space-time that we are observing the processes in. And so metric tensor is now will be a function of those parameters. Those parameters beta and gamma that we saw before, parameter gamma and beta and delta here. So these are the Eddington parameters. Those parameters that are entering the metric tensor, and when we compose propagation, and when we study equations of light propagation or dynamics of the planetary bodies, essentially we use that metric tensor. This is why the equations of motion for planets, spacecraft, and the light will all include parameters that are in the metric tensor. And again, those parameters now they represent different theories of gravity, because when you expand a particular theory of gravity, you get a different set of parameters, gamma and beta. But now you have a very generic metric where parameters beta and gamma just not fixed, and you can now study, for example, spacecraft motion or light propagation, and you can conduct experiments checking for the value of those parameters. In the full set of parameterized post-Newtonian formalism, there is essentially 10 parameters. Each of them represents a certain conservation law, and the energy momentum conservation, the angular momentum conservation, and they would represent different set of physical constraints. For example, alpha 1, alpha 2, alpha 3, those parameters are talking about preferred frame effects. And so parameter alpha 2, which is very interesting, I will talk about this parameter in the future. But all these parameters are coming into the metric, and metric is not, if you include all of those parameters, the metric will be rather not elegant. So I decided not to show, but if you would like to have them, yes, definitely, the full parameterized post-Newtonian formalism includes all set of 10 parameters. In general relativity, gamma and beta are equal to 1. In Brans-Dicke theory, beta is 1, but gamma now depends on the coupling, the strength of coupling of scalar field to matter. Remember, we're talking about this generic Lagrangian, essentially, and so omega is the coupling strength. So parameter gamma is a function of that coupling strength. So now when we conduct experiments, we can measure the value of gamma and beta and put constraints on for example, on this theory, Brunswicker theory. So using this metric tensor, we derive equations of motion. And so these equations of motion are in the planetary, in the equations that we use to navigate spacecraft in the solar system and study light propagation in the solar system. So this is, here you see those equations of motion. This is pretty much, it's a Newtonian contribution. And mg over mi, we use this to account for possible deviation of, for possible violation of equivalence principle. As we know, in general relativity, mg over mi is equal just one. But now if we unfold this ratio, you see that now parameter beta and gamma enter in here. And so that allows us to check for validity of equivalence principle using spacecraft and planetary motion. You see parameter beta and gamma everywhere in this equation. And also we put possible temporal variation of gravitational constant in. So if there is a variation of gravitational constant with respect to time or position, so we can put this additional term in the equation and study and put constraints on it. So these are the set of equations that we use to check for gamma, g dot, mg over mi, and beta. Essentially, this is the light equation. We study, this is the famous Shapiro delay. It's time delay when the light goes by the gravitational source, it being delayed by that gravity of the source. And again, you see the parameter gamma here. So moving on, some theories were predicting that parameter gamma is equal to 0 or minus 1. Basically, there were mostly theories that were using scalar or vector fields to explain gravitational phenomena. And we know from the Cassini experiment that gamma is measured to the level of 10 to the minus 5, deviating from 1. So therefore, those theories that predict gamma being equal 0 or minus 1 fail immediately. And so basically, there are quite a few of different theories fail by predicting a wrong value for post-Newtonian parameters. Moving on, this is the table. We discussed a number of those theories, but now, from a theoretical standpoint, you can expand those theories in the weak gravitational field and slow motion, and you can see that the 10 parameters that are present in the general, when analyzed from the general relativistic standpoint, produce the following values. For GR, gamma and beta equal to 1, and every other parameter is equal to 0. I'm not going to talk about every theory again here, but you see that each of those theories have quite a different set of parameters based on the particular mix of fields and particular set of approximations and assumptions used within those theories. So these are the scalar field theories. And then basically moving on, scalar tensor theories, you have a different set of parameters. Gamma again here depend on the strength of the coupling between scalar field and the matter. In the particular theory of gravity, beta is a parameter that is set by a particular theory. Then vector tensor theories, bimetric theories, because some of those approaches were using two metric tensors for different fields. And again, you see that those theories predict quite an interesting set of parameters. So the reason for me to show this to you is just to indicate that there is a very interesting phenomenology already accumulated for the last 25, 30 years, where the set of theories that we had initially is being analyzed, and now we have a very precise value for each of those parameters that we discussed based on different experiments conducted. But as you see here, those experiments are now were able to eliminate another set of theories in this list. Moving on, there is another interesting experiment that was conducted essentially when I analyzed the mercury perihelion advance. In 1980s, we noticed that if you analyze mercury perihelion precession, it is being expressed in the following form, where this contribution just will be based on the orbit of the Mercury, and here this is a contribution of the solar gravitational quadrupole. And essentially, until recently, there was assumption. Yes.
Do you hear me well? So I'll continue just one time. So there was a threat coming from the gravitational quadrupole of the sun. For example, if J2 would be larger than 10 to the minus 7, so then it would contribute a significant part of the, in a significant manner to the Mercury perihelion advance. So essentially, there was a
significant motivation to improve the value of the solar J2, and it was very difficult to do this based on the data on seismology and
magnetic measurements of the sun. People were able to constrain parameter J2 to roughly 10 to the minus
7, 10 to the minus 8, but results were not very precise. So here, very recently, Alex Konopliv from Jet Propulsion Lab and his colleagues in 2010 were able to analyze a set of planetary data in planetary spacecraft. Their analysis resulted in the solar J2 being measured of roughly 1.9, 10 to the minus 7. Therefore, J2 is well known now, and the Mercury perihelion advance is being well described by general relativity. But some theories, such as theory by Nee and Lightman-Nee, were not able to describe that Mercury perihelion advance to the precision that is now being achieved in the experiment. Moving on, gravitational waves. I will not be talking about gravity waves today because there will be next talk about gravitational waves. But essentially, some theories predict, in addition to the quadrupole, they also scalar fields. The scalar field radiates waves, and so you see that binary pulsar was able to confirm that, yes, to a certain level, first of all, this is indirect confirmation that gravity wave exists, and then also we are looking for, this experiment was able to eliminate a few theories that predict additional contribution to gravity waves. And so essentially those theories by Rosen and Rastal and Lightman-Lee and Lee and colleagues were able to, we're predicting quite a different values for gravitational wave radiation. So moving on, this is the list of parameters that we know them as we know them today. Again, from the standpoint of multiple experiments conducted in the solar system, you see that parameter gamma and beta are measured to a very impressive level, 10 to the minus 5 and 10 to the minus 4. And the other parameters are also measured to a very high precision using different data. So this is interesting, but then, so this is the present day. Moving into the solar system, which is the laboratory that we live in and we conduct our experiments, what we have today? We have the environment around the Earth, which is characterized by the dimensionless parameter. Basically gravitational potential around the Earth is roughly 10 to the minus 9 in dimensionless units. And the most interesting parameter, the largest ratio of GM over the sort of characteristic length is going to be around the sun, which is 10 to the minus 6. So this is our solar system. Only three orders of magnitude variation in gravitational potential. But then using this variation, we can achieve quite an interest in velocities and acceleration regimes, which will allow us to test gravity in even to a higher precision. But this is the solar system we can utilize for improving tests of gravity. In this chart, I will show the recent progress in the last 40 years in the test of gravitation. So what we've done in the past, we were using a Jet Propulsion Lab, we were using radar ranging to planets, Mercury, Venus, Mars, spacecraft, Mariners, Vikings, Pioneers, and so on. We actually done very long baseline interferometry, global position system, using the data to improve gravity. We also use laser engine, satellite laser engine, lunar laser engine, and soon there will be interplanetary laser engine. What I show here is the chart which measures on the y-axis is the unit curvature produced by sort of the unit mass. It's parameter gamma. And nonlinearity of gravitational superposition is beta. And we know that gamma and beta are basically just one and one. And so there were quite a few dedicated missions. Lunar laser engine is 1969 is still ongoing. Gravity Probe A, Bob Vesser experiment, and then recently launched LARIS, Italian experiment that is going to be using satellite laser engine to improve on the test of gravitomagnetic phenomena. And I hope I'm wrong here. I hope to see this mission flying much sooner. But I'm sort of, this is a wonderful mission that we're all waiting for, and hopefully it will be launched sooner, but sort of reality is such. So moving on, Mars ranging in 1976 constrained this parameter space to roughly deviating gamma from unity to roughly 10 to the minus 3. Mercury ranging is sensitive to gamma and beta because the orbit of Mercury is highly elliptic, and so we are sensitive to both parameters, so parameter space is constrained even further. So astrometric VLBI, which was done in 2009, constrained again parameter gamma less than 10 to the minus 4, and moving on, the lunar laser ranging constrained again the space even further. So you see the combination of the parameters beta and gamma constrained this possible violation of general relativity to less than 10 to the minus 4 again. And of course, Cassini. Cassini experiment constrained this parameter space even further. So basically, one can say, yes, so we can stop here because this is it. We know gravitational field is quite well. And so any possible deviation is within this is insignificant. And people may be right. But in reality, let's talk about the following. As we speak, general relativity now became an applied discipline. So you cannot navigate spacecraft without accounting for general relativity if you want to achieve precision measurement. For example, when we were studying space interferometry mission, that is a mission that will be measuring at some, so we were hoping that mission will be measuring angular, will achieve precision, in astrometric precision, roughly 1 microarcsecond. But now think about the following. Light coming in the solar system perpendicular to ecliptic at 1 astronomical unit from the sun is being deflected by the solar monopole to roughly 8 milliarcsecond. And we're talking about 1 microarcsecond. So what it means is that you have to achieve the precision that SIM was aiming to achieve, you must include general relativity in the model all the time, because sun, doesn't matter where you look, gravitational deflection is there in the data. So you will have to include, for example, for SIM and Gaia, and Gaia is a mission that is being now readied for launch in 2014 by European Space Agency, will achieve precision of roughly 1 microarcsecond as well. So they are accounting for gravitational contribution of the sun, Earth, Jupiter, and when you look close to the planetary bodies, you will have to account for gravitational deflection of those bodies as well. So, but then summarizing, the factor of 100 in 40 years, it is impressive, but it's not enough for the near future. And let me just maybe go quickly through the next charts. So the theories, some theories that resist to fail, based on the analysis that we had done, basically we have not been able to achieve the regimes where those theories were mostly for example, Planck scale energy is needed to understand the theory proposed by Bill and Nordwit and Helix and Nordwit. Those theories are vector tensor theories, and deviations can only be significant in large at large energies and so on. But based on this analysis, so basically people were concluding that aesthetic-based approach of the 20th century, basically only that theory, general relativity, is valid because it's simple, it's elegant, and therefore it must be considered as the standard theory of gravity. And yes, it is indeed, it is being considered as a standard theory of gravity, but now in 21st century, we have to move into different regimes where now we are faced with other challenges. How well do we know the gravity today? So this is my notional chart going from 1 micron, it's in the laboratory, and all the way to horizon scale. And essentially, how well do we know gravity on those various scales? And what theories do we have that predict deviation from general relativity? And techniques that we have that are available to explore gravitation on various scales. For example, in the laboratory, it is well tested to millimeter scale. We just started to approach micron distances where we can study for possible existence of fifth force. And here we know that very difficult to conduct experiments, and we are approaching this region only today. So the theory is very well, reasonably well tested within the solar system. And we just recently published a paper suggesting that the Pioneer anomaly is due to the thermal effects on the spacecraft. So I think we have a good handle on that effect, but flyby anomaly is still out of and we still need to invest some time to investigate flyby anomaly. It is very interesting. So moving into the galactic scales, dark matter, and on the cosmological scales, the dark energy, of course, we need to understand those puzzles. those are the theories that are available today that we are trying to utilize to study this phenomena, especially in the large scale. We're talking about infrared modified gravity, FFR gravity, brains, Dvalli Gabadadze parity, strength. There are many different theories which were suggested only within the last 10 years. It's a large list of theories which will not be, I will not be able to put this on the list, essentially. That list that we show in the 20th century now kind of sort of dimming a little bit compared to the list of theories that we have today that are being proposed to explain this interesting phenomena. So essentially, when you talk about dark matter, TEVIS, STVG theories were proposed by Milgram and Bekenstein and Moffat and some other people were trying to explain puzzles of dark matter by possible gravity modification. They're very interesting, This is a very interesting field for theorists, and this is a very interesting field as well. So moving on, what I see here is basically those experiments that are pretty much within from laboratory all the way to 1,000 astronomical units we can think about. And in fact, in 1980s, I think JPL studied a Tau mission, 1,000 astronomical units. And so Tau mission, people are already thinking how to get there. And technology pretty much within reach, we can think about possible experiments going all the way from laboratory, from the Earth, all the way to, let's say, a few hundred astronomical units. And you know that Voyager today is roughly at, what, 120 astronomical units? So we're already there. We're approaching that big gap, and we're getting our technologies allowing us to conduct controlled experiments all the way if we need to have a large potential variation, a velocity variation. And then astronomical observations, which would utilize the signals coming from outside in the solar system. And so I'm separating the two controlled experiments where we fly laboratory, essentially small-scale laboratory, where systematics is under our control, but we have to use either a gravitational field or velocity or some conditions that we create within the laboratory, or those signals that we're getting from the extrasolar system sources. And then basically different techniques are available to conduct those different interesting experiments, cosmological missions, cosmic microwave background research, and so on and so forth. There are some theories that suggest that, yes, even within the solar system, we might be able to see something very interesting. A very simple model that was put together almost, 20 years ago by Damur, Norvit, and Polyakov, studying a very simple model of a scalar field, suggests that one can expect deviations from general relativity, even in the solar system scales, at the level of roughly 10 to the minus 7 in terms of parametric gamma. Similar predictions exist for violation of equivalence principle. So people are suggesting that even within the solar system, you may be able to come up with an experiment that will test even further, even deeper the regimes, and study in possible contribution of the scalar field for present-day physics. Moving on, if you look at the FFR theories, where people just put in a very generic Lagrangian that depends through arbitrary function f from the Ricci curvature. Remember that gravitational Lagrangian in general relativity has only r, which is Ricci scalar. And so now if you put just arbitrary function and you work your way through the approximation, you get gamma minus 1 and beta minus 1 will depend on the shape of that function. So essentially, it connects the two regimes, solar system scale test and all the way to cosmology. Moving on, again, the zoo of different theories that were proposed recently suggests that you can actually come up with a very interesting Lagrangian that is testable through experiments in the solar system or going through cosmological research. I'm not going to talk about those theories as well, but basically I'm just showing that yes, indeed, in the 21st century, some of those new proposals are bringing back theories that we pretty much dealt with in the 20th century. For example, Kaluza-Klein theory, Brunsdicke theory, and Birkhoff, and Fierce and Pauli theory as well. So there are quite a few interesting reasons to test general relativity, and so many theories are back to the mix, and we would like to try to test them. Looking in the experiment that was conducted by Cassini, using radio waves at X band and Ka band, we were able to test parametric gamma to 10 to the minus 5. And essentially, those frequencies are needed because at the higher frequencies, you can come much closer to the sun. So impact parameter will be very, very small. And so the higher the frequency, the closer you come to the solar photosphere, and therefore you can have a stronger regime for
for testing gravity. But now, what do we have? In the future, for example, the techniques that we discussed today already, very long baseline interferometry, currently the result is 3 times 10 to the minus 4, but it is rather limited to 10 to the minus 4 because of the source structure. So we don't expect a major improvement from VLBI. Lunar laser engine, the currently measures parameter 8 to 10 to the minus 4. In about 5 years, we hope to get a one order of magnitude improvement. But then there are some challenges in modeling of the lunar laser engine experiment because of the lunar interior and some propagation effects through the Earth atmosphere. Ranging on Mars will allow us to measure parameter gamma to 10 to the minus 6. Tracking to Beppe Colombo at Mercury will probably lead us to 10 to the minus 6 measuring parameter gamma. And then optical astrometry, Gaia, will measure parameter gamma to 10 to the minus 6. This is what one can do as a piggybacking on somebody else's experiment. And now here, challenge us to come up with an interesting concept using technologies that at hand, quantum technologies, to actually improve the tests using a solar system environment and improve tests below what is possible today. Putting this in the chart, present value of parameter gamma measured by Cassini in 2002, it is here. Parameter delta A over A for equivalence principle is present value is here. G dot over G is lunar laser range in 2007. And this basically different theories that were proposed to motivate tests of gravitation in the solar system. And this is what those theories predict. So basically, Gaia, Beppe Colombo, Phobos laser engine, gravitational time delay mission, later Beacon will be able to improve. These are the missions that were proposed recently. Will be able to improve this measurement of parameter gamma by a few orders of magnitude, and so on and so forth. And so the new emerging technologies, this is very interesting. And this is what I'm personally here to learn, because the frequency standards and the precision that we're able to achieve today in the laboratory and what we hope to achieve in the future flying optical clocks in space, this is very interesting, very impressive, and we hope to benefit from the stability of the optical sources at the level of 10 to the minus 16 or maybe 10 to the minus 17 in the laboratory, because now we can improve the test of local Lorentz invariance, we can conduct experiments testing gravitation in the solar system. This is very interesting. And matter wave interferometers, this is very exciting, a new world altogether, because now we can use these devices to study the accelerations, rotation, to do gravity fields of planets. And so these are the technologies that are very much we are very much interested to see in the experiments. And so the purpose of this workshop is very much to discuss this possible technology, these technologies as a possible newcomers in the field. And this is my last slide. I'm concluding with the following statements: that recent technological progress essentially resulted in new instruments with unique performance. And I'm talking about essentially clocks, atom interferometers, because this is a very exciting technique that we very much in need in testing gravity in the solar system. And the techniques could lead to major improvements in the test of relativistic gravity, and already led to a number of experiments proposed, especially to European Space Agency that is funding those experiments quite well through cosmic vision exercises or through other programs. And then there are some challenges in the solar system. Sort of dedicated space-based experiments are very expensive, so the science must worth the money spent. So it's very challenging to propose new experiments, standalone experiments. So unfortunately, the series of JPA, JPB, and JPC probably will not continue. So, but we gravity probe A, gravity probe B. So unfortunately, so this sort of logic is very difficult to achieve. But those experiments that are most relevant, it's test of equivalence principle, G dot, and parameterized post-Newtonian parametric gamma. So this is most sort of relevant to the future tests. But again, we have to realize that gravitational field in the solar system is rather weak. So we have to look for a mission scenario which would utilize either a regime of high accelerations or basically access to gravitational field of the sun, or conducting experiments in the very close proximity to the sun, which is very important. And so then look for those anomalies. for example, the flyby anomalies that is still exist may indicate something, may indicate that it's just systematics on the spacecraft, but some people suggest that it may actually be relevant to some new physics. And again, I suggest that parameterized post-Newtonian formalism, even though we discussed it today, it became less relevant because many theories that were proposed recently cannot be placed within the constraints of parameterized post-Newtonian formalism because they predict different type of coupling and different symmetries in the theory. So there is a need to do some generalization of this approach to other models. And then what is puzzling is that if we try to connect cosmological research to solar system research, there is no really sort of one-to-one correspondence in the sense that some language that we used in the solar system research, such as energy momentum conservation, does not really translate well into the observables that are used in cosmology. So there is a desperate need for maybe cosmological PPN formalism so that we can make a correlation between the two domains. And that's basically all I have for the introduction as to what was done in the solar system for the last, 100 years, and to bringing us to the present day. And hopefully the technology that we will be discussing through this workshop will improve those tests by even more to really reach a precision that we can achieve in the solar system. Thank you very much.